So CRP has been widely touted as being important for a lot of species of birds, specifically early successional species, grassland birds in particular. This graph is from some work from Jim Kirker back in the 2000s, looking at the amount of that CRP habitat surrounding the landscape relative to the population trends of some of these species. More recently, some of these this habitat has been found to be important also for shrubland birds, especially given the relatively long time frames for some of these birds. Okay, so we know these lands are beneficial for birds, grassland birds, and many early successional birds. But kind of getting into the details of that, beyond just are they important and are these birds using them, how does that conservation practice, or I was interested in asking the question, how does that conservation practice affect the vegetation structure on these sites, and also the birds that are there, the density of those birds? Are there differences among these conservation practices, and how does that habitat use of those birds change kind of over time? So the objectives of this study were kind of looking at how does a conservation practice and site age influence vegetation structure. So the years or the site age they were looking at is between 4 and kind of 16 years. And so the vegetation structure that we looked at were nearest tree, grass cover, shrub cover, tree cover, and understory density. The cover categories are within 5 meters of the sample sites. The other objective was how does conservation practice and site age influence focal bird density? So the focal birds that we looked at are some declining birds in Illinois. And the conservation practices specifically that we're looking at in this study are CB22, riparian buffer, CB3A, arbor tree plantings, CB4D, permanent wildlife habitat, and CB23, wetland restoration. These happen to be the conservation practices that are most abundant in the CRAB program in Illinois, which is why we focused on them. The interesting thing is about these conservation practices, people hear hardwood tree planting, and of course you think that they planted a bunch of hardwood trees out there, and then every one of those sites you're going to go to, there's going to be a bunch of trees. That's not usually the case. When they planted the trees, if there had been flooding after that, maybe 2 years after that, a lot of those trees would die off or whatever. And so you go to that site, those types of sites, and think, oh, there's hardwood trees, and there wouldn't be any hardwood trees there. And in fact, my assessment after the first year is there wasn't that much visual difference between a lot of these sites because there's a ton of variability at the sites. But I still feel like it was worth going forward to kind of see how and if there were any differences between these sites. And so the focal bird species, we have two grassland species, dick sissels and northern bob whites. And then more shrubland species, so specifically Bell's vireo willow flycatcher, yellow-billed cuckoos, yellow-breasted chats, and brown thrashers. So this is just a map of my kind of the focal area for the CREP program in Illinois. On the left here, these are my sample sites where I visited, not just I, but a bunch of technicians and myself. So the bird sampling was conducted using point counts, standard point count sampling, unlimited radius. We randomized a selection of these sites, 172 sites throughout the state within that CREP area. Again, like I said, site age ranged from between four and 16 years, and we averaged 3 surveys per year. At those same point count locations, we collected vegetation data within a 5 meter radius, additionally using a modified Beaver protocol. In terms of analysis, we estimated bird densities using program distance, and then looked at both the vegetation variables and bird densities in an analysis of covariance, looking at conservation practice, age, and then interaction between those two variables. And in cases where there were interaction, we looked looked at kind of broke down the age into three separate categories to kind of tease out where the age, if there were conservation practice differences between age, where they were. And so in terms of vegetation, not surprising, understory density increases in all cases. There was no interaction between age and conservation practice. No real differences between between conservation practices, but again, not super surprising result there. Similarly, as the sites aged, grass cover increased. Again, not super surprising. In terms of some of these other variables, specifically like tree cover related and woody cover, we did have some interactions between age and CP. I'm sorry about the small graph, there's a lot to fit in here, but essentially the idea is that early on there weren't many differences. The primary difference was that CP22 had very few trees and CP4D or a lot of trees early on, and then CP4D had very few trees in terms of distance to nearest tree. But otherwise, not a lot of differences in the early stages. But then as these sites aged, CB3A, which is hard for tree planting, had significantly more trees and shrubs and woody cover. And the distance to nearest tree from the point count site drastically reduced. So essentially, as you might expect, as these sites age, the tree cover and the woody cover kind of increases. In terms of the bird results, so the Bell's vireo, they were most numerous at CP3A sites, specifically, and there were differences between CP23 and CP3A relative to the others. In terms of yellow-billed cuckoo, CP23 had the highest densities, and that was different from all the other conservation practices. In terms of the brown thrasher, CP40 generally was different from all the rest in that it had much lower densities of birds. And then in terms of the Dick Sisal, there was an interaction between conservation practice and age, and generally the later time periods, the middle and late, were significantly higher than the rest of those conservation practices. And so the conclusions, again, not super surprising, understory density increases over time, and grass cover increases over time among all the conservation practices, and trees and shrubs generally increase with age. However, the CPs kind of respond differently, with CP3A having significantly more shrubby and woody cover. And in terms of the conclusions for birds, so CP3A and CP23 are most important for shrubland species. CP4D is important for grassland species. And age is not a strong influence for the majority of these bird species, aside from Dick Sisal, which is, again, not surprising given the successional breadth that they kind of look, that they occupy. But relative to some of these other species, if you looked at the literature, the age ranges of these sites that you'd expect that would be optimal for these species, our results show that a lot of these species have a much wider successional breadth, at least on these sites, than you would have, what you would have thought given the literature or even given some people's expert opinion. In terms of implementing these sites, in terms of managing these kinds of sites, I think this is kind of an important takeaway from the study is if you want to increase Dick Sisals or grassland birds, more CP4D sites are important. Again, CP3A and CP23 would be more important kind of for shrubland bird species. With that, I'd like to acknowledge all the participating groups that helped me and funded this research, as well as a lot of technicians and people, agency people that kind of helped me along the way. And with that, I'll take any questions.
well-maintained and in compliance with respect to their practice. Because if there was a, you know, more grass land, but they, unless they were negligent in controlling weeds, that it would have been shrubbier than it should have been, and I don't think.
We didn't take that into account, and also, even if we had, I don't know how good of detailed information that the locals here, you know, NRCS officers would actually have. Maybe if I had in-depth conversations with some of the people who were in charge of those contracts, they would, but we kind of didn't take that into account. We broadly just looked at where these sites were most concentrated for logistical reasons, and then kind of stratified that, you know, and ran an example through with those counties.
Did you actually see bobwhite quail on the sites? I'm just curious, that part of Illinois would be, I don't know what the prevalence is there, but I saw it was one of your species that you listed, but I didn't see the independent graph. I'm just curious if there were bobwhite there.
They were there. They weren't there in very high densities. You know, I wouldn't call the area where we looked at a good place to start managing for bobwhite quail, but they were definitely